Welcome to the God's Word portion of the worship from Daleville Christian Church. We're doing a little different format today because you and I have been blessed this week. We can be grateful that I completed work on this sermon message before I read the news on Tuesday. After I finished work on the sermon, I read a story of a pastor in our state who confessed to adultery 20 years ago. But the victim in this case was in the worship that day and came up and said, "Well, here are the details. I was 16 years old and I was sexually abused for 9 years. The pastor only confessed to having had an affair 20 years ago. The pastor's accuser and her husband came forward to explain more horrible details. Then I read a story from the Southern Baptist Convention, the largest Protestant denomination in this country. Their report was on the sexual abuse that clergy have committed on young women, and boys. The report was necessary because most of these same clergy were never disciplined or prosecuted or thrown out of the denomination. The offenders included a former president of the Southern Baptist Convention. Then I read about the mass murder in Texas of school children and teachers. Come to find out that evil is just as strong this week, and evil resides in our churches. In the church's highest offices, why should I even bother to let my light shine? Then I remembered that Elijah was discouraged, 1 Kings 19. Jonah was discouraged, Jonah chapter 4, and Job was miserable. And their stories are still in the Bible to encourage us. I was reminded that the successes of the gospel in this country are because of the gospel, not the messengers of the gospel. My old debate coach used to say, "It's possible that you won this debate in spite of what you did, not because of what you did." These pastors have been successful, and make no mistake, these pastors have been successful in every American measure of success. But they've been successful in spite of themselves, not because of themselves. They've been successful because the gospel is successful. The gospel is still the most beautiful story ever written. These pastors appear successful because of the power of the gospel and of Christ's kingdom. These pastors are not successful because they are criminals in hiding. The pastor who assaulted a teenager for 9 years only made his confession because the elders of the church told him he had to confess. And then he didn't make a complete confession. The crimes of these pastors are coming to light, and one day everyone will know the truth of their deeds. These pastors and their churches appear successful because the light of the gospel is shining brighter than any pastor. It's in this knowledge and in this truth that I bring today's message, another message on God's love for you. But first, a psalm I usually turn to when I'm troubled by the news. Psalm 73. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my foot had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold. Another version says, I almost stopped believing this truth. I had almost lost my faith. For I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. They have no struggles. Their bodies are healthy and strong. They are free from common human burdens. They are not plagued by human ills. Therefore, pride is their necktie. They clothe themselves with violence. From their callous hearts comes iniquity. Their evil imaginations have no limits. They scoff and speak with malice. With arrogance, they threaten oppression. Their mouths lay claim to heaven, and their tongues take possession of the earth. Therefore, their people turn to them and drink up waters in abundance. They say, "How will God know? Does the Most High know anything?" This is what the wicked are like. Always free of care, they go on amassing wealth. Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and have washed my hands in innocence. All day long I have been afflicted, and every morning brings new punishments. If I had spoken out like that, I would have betrayed your children. When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply till I entered the sanctuary of God. Then I understood their final destiny. Surely you place them on slippery ground, Lord. You cast them down to ruin. How suddenly are they destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. They are like a dream when one awakes. When you arise, Lord, you will despise them as fantasy. We use an affirmation of our faith each time we gather together, and we turn again to Titus chapter 2. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. The gospel for today is from Luke chapter 15, the first 7 verses. Jesus is teaching, and he shares one of his parables. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them the parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep, loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me. I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. We return to the topic of God's love. Why? Even though I preached on love about 25 times the last several years, there are 2 verses, Bible verses, that keep us on the topic of God's love. The one verse I've used as a blessing from the apostle for us all at the close of our worship, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and how high and how deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all fullness of God. To know this love that surpasses knowledge. One version says it's this way: Christ loves greater than any person can ever know, but I pray that you will be able to know that love. Our Lord's love is greater than we can know, and yet the apostle prays that you and I will know that love. curious, isn't it? Should we give up trying to understand love? No. Why not give up trying to understand God's love? God's love's like chemistry or higher math. It's just too hard. No. The reason to not give up comes from God in Colossians, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord, growing in the knowledge of God. That's our call, to know more. Hebrews 8:11, no longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me from the least to the greatest. 2 Peter 1:8, for if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And another blessing from the apostle, same letter, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And if you had any doubts about this topic for this week, as I went to the Bible Gateway website, which I use almost every day, the Bible verse for the week last Tuesday was Romans 12:10, be devoted to one another in love. Another version says, honor one another above yourself. Think our Lord's trying to tell me something? Having committed my personal self to this topic in the last few years, it's helpful to read it from other pastors, how they have struggled to teach this topic of love, God's love. Jesus used stories to teach about God's love, and Jesus acted out God's love, healing those who called upon him, lifting up the despised, the poor, and making even a tax collector one of his own disciples, and ultimately giving his life for us all on the cross. Pastor Chip Ingram, whom I've quoted to you before, wrote, when I began this study on the attributes of God, I thought love would probably be the easiest to write about. I was wrong. As I have thought about God's love, I have felt more and more inadequate to put into words. Pastor Chip Ingram continued, in seeking what God longs for us to see about his love, we walk on holy and mysterious ground. He finished the page saying, the idea of his love seems so familiar until we actually start thinking about it. I'm now convinced that God's love is one of the hardest attributes for us to get a handle on. And that's from his book, God As He Longs for You to See Him. Maybe one of the keys to this knowledge of God and God's love is the word knowing, or to know. Maybe we can't know God's love like we know basic math. You can do some addition in your head without even being aware of it. 2 and 2 is 4. It's not even thought. There it is. That's what I and others often refer to as head knowledge. Remember Jesus' question to Peter, but what about you? Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. Knowing who Jesus is was not then and is not now head knowledge. It can start as head knowledge. You know Jesus of Nazareth, who walked the earth, who traveled from town to town, who spoke, whose words are written down. That's head knowledge. And you may know those before you come to know Jesus by the Holy Spirit as the Christ, the Messiah. God's anointed to save you and me. Saul of Tarsus knew Jesus as a problem first, a convicted criminal whose followers were causing trouble. But on the road to Damascus, the light of Christ revealed to Paul's blinded eyes who Jesus really was. People often come to Jesus as Lord and Savior in one of five ways. And I didn't originate this, but I don't have an author to point to. People come to Jesus as Lord and Savior when they understand Jesus as teacher, or when they see Jesus as a shepherd, or when they see Jesus as a healer, or when they see Jesus as the giver of life, giver of new life, or they see Jesus as our ransom, our redeemer, our savior, our rescuer. He died in our place. All of these are expressions of God's love in and through Jesus. Many of these are expressions of God's love. Many of the pillars of the Christian faith would place themselves as having experienced Jesus in one of those five ways. That Jesus healed them, or brought them through an illness, or led them through a crisis as shepherd, or taught them what to do in their difficulties, forgave their pasts as redeemer, rescuing them from their old life, or showing them and giving them a new life. That means that these same people experience these expressions of God's love these ways. They experience them. But it may be only one of these ways, while our Lord continues to operate through all five of these ways. One pastor emphasized that it is important to experience God's love in one way or another. All the ways I have listed are experiences of God's love. Pastor Tim Keller reminds us in his book, The Prodigal God, we often use the law court idea in understanding what Jesus did for us. Jesus takes our punishment, which frees us from any further penalty. We are pronounced guilty, but our punishment went on Jesus. So there isn't more for us to do. Now, later, or ever. We are free despite our criminal past. Pastor Keller states that it's all courtroom talk, and most of us have never been in a courtroom. Maybe not even traffic court. Pastor Tim states that salvation is also an experience. The Bible uses sensory language, taste and see. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalm 34. Isaiah chapter 53, but he was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. By his wounds we are healed. Isaiah 53. The words of the prophet Isaiah sound more like medicine, the body. Hundreds of years before what we know as modern medicine, but we can't escape its meaning. Jesus was pierced for our transgressions. And the King James Version reads, he was bruised for our iniquities. Pastor Keller quotes the Puritan father, Jonathan Edwards, and I would paraphrase it this way. Claiming that God loves you is different from feeling loved by God. As different as talking about the sweetness of honey without ever tasting the honey. Pastor Keller states, while believing that God is loving, we can come to sense the reality and power of God's love. The experience of this love can be more real and constant than any human love you might have experienced in your lifetime. We so often come to the communion meal, our Lord's table, with judicial thoughts and hearts. I ought to know I grew up in the Christian church tradition in the Midwest. But the meal is a celebration of love. Isn't that the word, love feast? in our Bibles, in Jude's letter, verse 12. And what about Jesus' story of the father with two sons? What happens at the end? A celebration. And what does Jesus' father in the story say to his son, who doesn't want to go to the party? We had to celebrate and be glad. If you have never come to this table glad, you might be missing the best part of the celebration. Do you not believe that our Lord, who left us this table, celebrates us and our presence here in his name? Who spoke of the shepherd who came home saying, "Celebrate with me." The disciples are recorded in Acts chapter 2. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad hearts. Can you be glad that God loves you this